Okay, nice. So I don't want to have a lot of dependencies. Why? Because the dependencies, it means more work for me. I have to keep them updated. And for the past couple of years, I really wanted to prune anything that I don't use from any of my systems, including my personal laptop and including anything that I work on as a daily job. So why we want to go minimal? And the short answer is because we can. So the long answer is that even if you just need two commands to keep your packages on NetBSD up to date, which is package in update and package in upgrade, it still requires time and effort. I don't want to waste any more time. And I just don't want to update anything that I don't use. So what was my path to that type of thinking? My first laptop had FreeBSD with KDE. I enjoyed it quite a lot, but KDE upgrades sometimes failed. And back then I had time to fix those breakages. Then during an NYCBSD meeting, George told me that he was using XFCE. I tried it, it was way more lighter, it could run better on laptops and required less dependencies. Still, I mean, I worked on a project later that I didn't have access to a fancy GUI environment. I managed to set up a convenient working environment. You can see my talk from 2019. Then out of curiosity, I bought the Pinebook, which we unfortunately couldn't get the wireless running on it. And I installed NetBSD on it. That was purely out of curiosity. The thing costed me $100, so it was nothing. And I decided to try it. It cannot run, or if it runs very slowly, any type of heavy graphical interface, KDEs, GNOMEs, simply it's not pleasurable to run them. So I started using it mainly in text mode. So and finally, in last year in December, I was traveling to Europe. I got stuck for one day in Germany because of snowstorm, and I had to phone and email all my relatives, I mean my family, and I told them I'm okay, I'm just stuck in the airport. And then out of nothing, I got the idea, I mean, if I just had the Pinebook, what type of configuration, what type of setup I can do so that I can do all those email messages and so on with just plain NetBSD and almost no dependencies. So this is the, and then I got back to Bulgaria and then I started working on that idea. So the NetBSD installation, the Pinebook comes with Android. I still haven't moved Android from it because it can the laptop can boot from micro SD card, and I don't want to simply mess with the eMMC storage to remove Android. So I never removed it. There is a NetBSD live image that can be written on a micro SD card. So I found several links quite useful. NetBSD ports, it lists what NetBSD hardware supports. ARC64 describe the port that runs on Pinebook. Of course, you don't have a central documentation. If you want to know more about the architecture, you need to really Google. There are a bunch of books that describe the ARM64 architecture. I've read parts of it, but I'm not much of an expert. So there is a place where you can download the binaries, and in that place there is install.html document, which is very useful, and this is what... So next. So you need to download the live image. So you simply, on another machine that has curl or whatever, you can download it from a regular browser. You run curl and you install a file that's called ARM64 image GZ, and then you unzip it. Now here, yes.
Before you get too deep into the NetBSD specifics,
yes.
Can you say why you chose to install NetBSD as opposed to any other BSD or any other OS?
Yes, I can tell. So I bought, when I bought the laptop, I opened it, Google, and I searched Pinebook BSD. I mean, I have read some of the forums. People are running OpenBSD on it, also NetBSD. And the first link that popped up was Pinebook with NetBSD. So this is the reason. Now, the second thing that I did is, as you can see, you run it on a micro SD card, which simply you can buy several micro SD card and you can install whatever BSD images you want. So at home somewhere, I have a second micro SD card with OpenBSD. And the reason that I'm talking about NetBSD is that during my trip, I got the NetBSD SD card. So on the airport, when I plug in, I have plugged it in, I got NetBSD. So not very much of a reason, but this is why I'm talking about NetBSD. No specific reason. And then you use DD in order to transfer the uncompressed image to the SD card. Now, one thing is you're going to need an SD card reader. If you go to Staples and you buy an SD card, the micro SD card, they come with adapters. So you put it in the adapter, you plug it in the thing, you get the USB cable, you plug it into the machine, you check in the message that device, what device the USB thing is mapped into, you run DD, and you get it installed. Now, one thing to be very careful about. I already had NetBSD running on my Pinebook, so when I was doing all that thing, I plugged in the SD card to the Pinebook. So when I did the thing, I actually I destroyed my real SD card from which I was booting NetBSD, and this is why this talk is delayed by 1 month. So that's the place where you have to be extra careful. Now, you need to make the SD card bootable, and Pinebook runs U-boot bootloader, so it's some sort of BIOS. Well, it's a bootloader, so technically, yes, BIOS is also a bootloader. Here it gets a little bit interesting. U-boot is a very, how can I say, it's quite an interesting project. If you Google it and if you open it, you may get lost in the documentation. If you are interested in bootloaders, it's amazing. So as a bootloader, it works in several stages, and you need to find the secondary program loader. And there is a NetBSD package that contains it. So you look for U-boot Pinebook. You install it, and again, you use DD in order to transfer that specific file to your SD card, and you just need to check the binary so that you install it where it is supposed to be installed. Now, and the DD commands are the only dangerous commands that I'm going to mention tonight. Finally, so when you have your SD card, you just plug it here, and you reboot the Pinebook, and NetBSD starts booting up. If you check atcrc.conf, you're going to see that there are two or three environment variables that are configured to extend your image. So once you boot it, it will resize the root partition to whatever to fill the whole SD card. And then it reboots, and the system is almost ready. You may have certain rough edges. The problem that I had is I had the network adapter plugged in. For some reason, it was bombarding my console with messages up to the point that the console became unusable. Originally, the setup in the live image, you just have one console available. So what I had to do is I had to unplug the network adapter, just to do the initial configuration up to setting up the additional TTYs. So, and then we go back to initial configuration. So, the image comes with empty string as the root password. We need to change the root password, and so we log in, we type nothing, and then we change it. And the next step is to add a non-root user, because we don't want to work as root. We type user add. I'm adding that user to the will group for the reasons that will become clear pretty soon. And then we need to configure the TTYs. So you open HC TTYs. You have 5 TTYs. 4 of them are off. 4 of them are disabled. You change off to on, and you kill the init process. And now you have 4 more additional TTYs. The next step is obviously configuring the wireless, which we cannot do here. NetBSD comes with WPA supplicant. You put your SSID, you put your password, you set up WPA supplicant to boot, to start on boot by adding this line to rcconf, and then we restart it, and then you try if you can ping nycbug.org, and then you can look at your IP address. Now, one of the problems that I had with the wireless is that, so imagine if you sit in a public cafe or in the airport, so you can scan the available networks. You can see the SSIDs. Most probably, they will not require passwords. However, the problem is that when you connect to them, usually they pop up in your browser some message: do you confirm to the terms? Do you promise that you're not going to use our network for bad stuff? Once you click OK, they connect you. So in some places, I was not able to connect to the Wi-Fi simply because I don't have the interface to see to check the terms and conditions. Of course, you can always open X, fire up Firefox, and confirm there. These are the problems that I have. Now we want to configure a package manager. Of course, we have package underscore add in NetBSD and in all BSDs. I prefer package in because I can search for packages. So we are going to use actually package add to install package in, and we need to set up the package path. We set it up and we run package add package in, it installs it. One thing to watch is generally a package path can supports technically HTTP or HTTPS. I was not able to get it to work under HTTPS, and the reason about that is that at that point of time I don't have the certificates. Yes, I don't have the certificates, and without the root CA certificates, HTTPS throws an error. So here you need to fall back to HTTP, and then you install package in. Now, that's, I guess, and then you need to configure package in. This is its configuration file. atcpackageinrepositories.conf. You can actually put HTTPS right here, and the reason about that is that I believe that packageIn has the root certificate, most probably hard-coded into it for that CDN website. I don't know why package add doesn't work with HTTPS, but packageIn works. So the next thing is, now we have the package manager. The other thing is, we don't want to work as root, and actually I forgot to mention, the reason that I added those initial user to the wheel group is that I want to use it to switch identities. So I actually, I think I mentioned it somewhere. Yes, so I add that user to the wheel group so that I can run sudo dash and become root. So, but now I don't want to use su, I prefer to use sudo in order to run just specific commands, commands as root. So we go and we install sudo, we give ourselves permissions, we give the wheel group to the permissions to run anything we want, and that's it. So for complete treatment of sudo, read the book Sudo Mastery by Michael Lucas. I read it myself. So now, at that point of time, we set up completely our laptop. We can write a book with it. We can organize our expenses with Oak because it's the tax season. I really do it. I mean, I really have a file that's called expenses. I put everything and I let Oak do the arithmetics. And we can do some development with CC and make. So now I'm going to just to list a bunch of programs that I actually find useful and that I use almost daily. So the first one is my integrated development environment, which is called tmux. So tmux is a multiple, is a terminal multiplexer. It's in the NetBSD base system. You don't need to install it. It's there. You can use it. So the way I use it, actually, I can demonstrate after we.
It works. The Wi-Fi works.
The Wi-Fi works.
I keep ping.
Okay, but now I have to waste time connecting. So let's do it a little bit later. Yes. So in tmux, you can split the screen into. You can split your window in as many panes as you want. Usually, I use three panes. When I develop, one of them is to write the source code, the other one is to write the unit test, and the third pane is the shell where I build and compile and test. Now, the other thing is, which is, I think, the best tmux feature, is imagine that you SSH to some server over VPN or over some network. The network goes down, the VPN goes down. However, if you have your tmux session, nothing is lost. When the network is back, you just SSH back and you say tmux attach, and it attaches to your existing session. I haven't found any commercial tool that does it. So the other thing is I want to discuss is envstat. Envstat is used for battery monitoring. The laptops, you plug it, you unplug it, especially if you have cats and dogs, you want to monitor your battery. So the envstat command gives that information. So that's the battery percent. The envstat command is a part of a bigger framework, which is called envsys. Usually it provides statistics and information about the hardware that you run. So it has the notion of devices. For example, here the battery is one device, and here you have another set of sensors that monitor the CPU temperature. So you can register additional sensors if your hardware supports them. And however, getting back to the battery, this is the device XPP-MIC0. We run envstat command, we pass it through ARC, and we get a nice good number which specifies the battery percentage. Now, what we do with the battery percentage, we can display it in tmux because we have tmux almost always opened. In order to control tmux behavior, you can use its options. This is how you view the options. The next thing is next. So you create a tmux configuration file in your home directory. You can set up the status right option, And here in that command bat.sh, this is where we put the env.stat execution along with the awk parsing. And it will show it once you restart tmux, you're going to have your battery percentage in tmux. So the next thing is email with mut, because we need to communicate. So we install mut. So first we need to create a configuration file, and I'm going to demonstrate it with a Gmail account. So first you set the TLS options to yes. Next you put your Gmail address, then next you put your real name. You set up the IMAP user, and then you set up the password. One thing about the password is that it's not a good idea to use your official Google password. What you can do is you open your Gmail account. There is a way to generate the so-called application passwords, but you need to have the two-factor authentication. It generates something long and something random. You copy it, you put it in that file, you set up that file to be readable only by you. Then you set the IMAP URL, and then the spool file, it's your main inbox. So this is just enough to read your email. So if you, at that point of time, if you start MUT, it will start downloading your messages. Now, I have a lot of messages, so it downloads all of them, and it's very slow in the first run. You can cache the message headers and the messages, and once you cache them, the subsequent starts up are way faster. Now, by default, MUT sorts the email by the date it receives. If you want your newest email at the top, you have to reverse the thing. Now, we would also want to send email. So we set up the SMTP URL, and you set the SMTP pass, which is the same as the application password above. And now we want to test it. You can actually test mail sending from the command line, and actually you can send emails from the command line. So you echo something and you say mut send subject. You put the subject and you provide the destination address. So, and then here it says no authenticators available. Now, the reason about that is that mut uses Cyrus SSL to do the authentication. By default, this package Cyrus SSL, it doesn't install any authenticators. So it just installs the general framework, and then it says you need more authenticators. After some trial and error, I discovered that it needs CY to log in. We install this package, and then we run the, and then we are able to send any email. Now, the next thing is we will also want to set up IRC. Although the other day I read a message in XFC mailing list, they said that they are going to stop using IRC, and they are moving to Matrix, whatever. So, yes. Internet relay chat. NetBSD provides several IRC clients, and as I mentioned, with pkgin you can search for any package, and pkgin search IRC gives a list of them. I picked up IRC IRS SSI. We are going to demonstrate how to connect to the NYCBUG channel at LiberaChat. So the first thing you need is nickname registration. Now, the nickname registration depends on actually the IRC server you're using. There are IRC servers that don't require nickname registration. But if it is required, here's how you do it. So you start up the IRC client, you set your nick, and then by default, IRC SI, it has a bunch of networks which are predefined. So that command slash network lists the networks. LiberaChat is in the networks. So we connect to the LiberaChat server, and then we say message, NIC server, register, and then you type your password and your email. And this is going to register your nickname if it is not occupied, if it is available. So you will receive an email which you can read it in MUT. And they're going to send you a token. Once you receive the token, you go back to the IRC client and you type message NIC server verify register your NIC and your token. So this is how you register a nickname, and then you just connect to LiberaChat once again. You identify your NIC, and then you join NYCBUG. And this is it. So one thing to know about IRC is that all comments, they start with slash. If you send something that does not start with slash, it is considered a message. So welcome to the channel. Now, web browsing. So there are three text-based web browsers. I have been using links, so it doesn't support JavaScript, which means that it's not interactive, but there are also no banners and no advertisements, which is... Elinks has some JavaScript support. I've never tried it. W3M can display images on suitable terminals, which means that if you open X window and if you pick a terminal that has some graphic capabilities, if you run W3M, you can see images. However, to get back to links, first, as I mentioned, you need to install the certificate authority certificates. Without it, every time you open something that's HTTPS links throws warnings, then you update those CS certificates, and then finally you install links. And then you type links, HTTPS. Yes?
Did you install the certificates before you tested SMTPS in MUT?
Yes. Do you say that if I install the...
No, it's just the order in which you did this, you installed the certificates. Now, I mean, you probably just know how you normally do it, but it seems in order to test sending securely an email, you would have to have a certificate.
Yeah.
Like that. That's all I have to say.
Yes.
Okay. So it's just out of order how you probably did it.
Gmail wouldn't accept it if you tried without the...
This is also my understanding is that Gmail wants it wants TLS. How does it handle it? Most probably it uses some, if you don't have the root certificates, can it use some ephemeral certificate?
Well, the certificate is for the client end, right?
Yes.
Right, the server is not validated. There's no client server. Right, so
you can have it though. You can have a client certificate.
In this case, it's not, you're not authenticating using a client, so you're authenticating using a password over whatever the secret, right? The certificate is for the client's benefit to verify you're actually talking to people.
Then it's verifying the CA, the certificate of authority.
Right,
that's
exactly
what we're doing here. So it will work, usually, depending on the software you're using, it will work if you say, yes, I accept GeoTrust or Verisign or whatever, but it's easier if you install that first. Right. Depends on the software though.
Right. No, I also ask this because it very much it says SMTPS, so that's how I know you're definitely using something secure.
And if you know the signature of the cert, it's not less secure though. So, I mean, if you've seen this a million times, if you've seen the cert as SMTP cert, it's not, like for a first start, I think it's fine.
How people build their boxes and their order and everything else is like.
I know for sure that if you install links without that package CS certificates, it throws errors. It never occurred to me to test MUT with or without the without the CS certificates. I don't think it will matter though. So even. Here I don't have the certificates. However, I was able to send email over SMTPS. So I don't know what certificate it's using.
It must not be verifying.
So
yeah, most probably, yes. Yeah.
Okay, the input button on the
Okay, cool. We have it.
I guess the question to me is, like, taking a step back for a minute.
Yes.
I've always been someone who took old laptops and, like, left them in the data center. Like, I have a Dell Inspiron 1100, which has fallen from, like, 5 feet multiple times and keeps working. But I guess the problem has always been for me has been, you know, I run FVWM, CWM.
The default CWM. One. Hmm? Is this that's the default one?
On OpenBSD, yeah. It's CWM or FVWM. But I'll run that because you can do, you know, it takes nothing. I mean,
yes.
But the question is are you using the mail for work stuff? I mean,
no.
This is where the problem comes in. It's attachments, it's, you know, someone sends these, you know, horrifying HTML emails. Oh. And if you look at it in LaTeX.
I use Mud as my daily mail reader. It'll handle attachments. I either go to links and read the HTML stuff in links, or I save the attachments and use something local to.
Because you have a window manager. You install the window manager, right? You install the window manager, so you actually have X.
I have X, but I don't use it. Now, the thing about HTTP email, which means, I hate it. So every time I can opt out for regular text email, I do it. So unfortunately, I mean, important stuff like airplane tickets and so on, they send it over HTTPS. So to some extent, we don't have a choice. I mean, that's pretty cool to, you know, sort out 80% of the bullshit in your life. But for some stuff, you just need a graphical environment. So you can still, as I said, fire up X and read it in Firefox. This is, I would say, very nice exercise. I would guess that if you work anywhere close to servers, you need to know how to handle command line and text interface. And I will say nothing for the time being. So I'll continue. Yes. Very good. So Lynx doesn't support JavaScript. You cannot view images. However, you can do one very interesting thing with it. So imagine that if you open Firefox in a graphical environment, you just type a search query, you press enter, and it gives you the result in your search engine. So now, can we do something like this? Can we run some command, type in a search query, and can we have the results popped up automatically? So I use TCL and expect to automate interactive programs when I want them to automate them. So in this case, I rolled out a small expect script. So it spawns links with the duckduckgo. Once it spawns it, it looks for search in the screen, in the output. And then it sends a tab that's to focus the search field. Then it sends the query that I've sent it. Then it sends enter. Here it expects, I forgot why I put it, but I need it. It sends a, yes, you have to double press enter. So virtually in links, in order to submit a query, you need to press 2 times enter. So that thing simply press 2 times enter, and then it says interact, which means release the control and give the control back to user. So after I run that thing, I get links browser automatically popped up with all the searches that I want. I can demonstrate it later. So we need the TCL expect package, and once we install it, you can run, I named this one DuckX, and we typed, we searched for NYCBUG messages, and it appears. So why, how I found this, I had a very stubborn vendor that was providing some libraries, and they wanted to authenticate, although everybody knew the password. So they wanted to authenticate, and they also setting up some cookies, so I couldn't use CURL directly. So what I did is I wrote out that script. I passed the username and password from the command line. I run it, and I downloaded the file through links, and it saved me a couple of clicks. Now the thing is, when I that was in a previous project of mine, when I offered that workflow to some of my coworkers, they simply told me to shut up. So the guys, they wanted to download the file, transfer it over STP or whatever to wherever it needed to be. I was doing that with one comment, and no one would listen to me. So in any case, sound and sound applications. So the Pinebook has a sound system. There is a comment which is, again, from the NetBSD base system. It's called audio CFG. You run it with the list arguments, and it runs the sound devices that it finds. So the first one is from the jack here. That's the default thing, and the other one is HDMI audio, which I don't know what that is, simply because I'm not a big audio guy. So the device with the asterisk is the default one. It has index 0, and you can actually submit a test command, and you can say test the device with index 0. Initially, I did not hear anything because the volume was 0. So we had to increase the volume. The command mixer control shows and control the volume. It shows a bunch of other options. So mixer CTL, mixer control minus A, it's going to show all the options and all the settings it has. Outputs master is what we want. So the minus W option, it sets up the volume to a certain value. So you set it up, you test it, and finally I was able to hear some sound. So you have the audio play command, which can play WAV files. So I found this website HTTPS sample lib that contains samples of many file formats, including WAV, MP3, various graphical formats. So you can use them without licensing. So it's free. You download them. You do whatever you want. So I download several WAV files, and I actually tested audio play with them. So you increase the sound a little bit more, and then you say audio play dot WAV files, and it does play. You have a sound. So the WAV file format, it stores the audio data in an uncompressed format, so it's the files are larger. On the other hand, MP3 format uses lossy data compression, but the files are way smaller. So MP123 can play MP3 files. I installed it, downloaded some MP3 files from sample lib, and I ran it, and it played them. All of that from the command line. So MPEG-123 is a very versatile player. You can create playlists, play random tracks, loop, and so on, if you like that type of stuff. Yes, and out of curiosity, I created a small script that compares the size of the WAV files with the size of the same files in MP3 format. The compression is 10 to 1. Podcasts. Yes, this section is thanks to Patrick. I've actually found the BBC podcast by writing that thing. It's amazing. You can listen to BSD now as well. So the podcasts are radio programs made available for downloading over the internet. The way it works is the publisher declares some RSS feeds that contain information about the podcasts. You download the RSS feed, you parse it, you find the URLs, and the podcast DL does all of that. So we install it, we create one configuration file which simply lists the podcast we want to follow. So usually it's something that contains RSS in it. So this is the BSD Now, and this is the BBC podcast. You run podcast DL with cmin's configuration file. You pass that configuration file. You specify the local output directory. And you say, I want the stuff from the last 3 days. It downloads the stuff, and you play with MPEG 1, 2, 3. So I really like the BBC podcast. Now, one thing is, podcast DLL, it throws some errors. I think it's some sort of a C program. And I mean, the guys don't give good error messages. I have plans to rewrite something with shell script. So, external media. Every now and then we need USB sticks and CDs. Now nobody uses CDs except if you have old backed up data. You use CDs? Okay. I have two USB sticks. If you want, I can give them to you. So I want to go into some details about the USB sticks, because when you initialize a USB stick, you need to run old programs like FDisk, and you need to build file systems. And nowadays, I mean, it's very informative in terms of when you actually install an operating system, you do those steps. So you get a USB stick, you plug it in, you run the message. When you run the message, you can see what device it is actually mapped to. In this case, it's mapped to SD0. Now, there is an interesting message here, fabricating a geometry. So when you had the old spinning disks, they had several plates, and they had several reading heads, and they have sectors and records. So by geometry, it means, first of all, how many heads it has, how many sectors, and what was it? How many sectors per head, or how many?
Plates per sector.
Yes.
Sectors per tracks per cylinder, cylinders and platters.
Yes, so, and this is what,
yes,
what? Yes, and this is what? This is what we mean by geometry. Now that type, it's the technology is still there, so we cannot just make it disappear for overnight. Which means that for some point, we have to support it. Now the USB sticks, they don't have cylinders, they don't have reading heads, they don't have that type of stuff. So we need the operating system has to lie that it has some geometry. And this is why it says fabricating a geometry. So once you have the thing plugged in, you need to zero it. So you take the dev0 device, which is simply a device that gives you an endless sequence of zeros, of null bytes, and then you run DD, and then you zero the USB stick. After that, you have to initialize a partition on that USB stick. Obviously, if you want to share that stick from a machine to a machine, you need to use the most popular partition, and that MS-DOS. So imagine that you use it only for BSD or only for NetBSD. You can actually partition it in NetBSD format, and you can, mount it as an additional NetBSD drive. So in order to create a partition, you need to run FDisk. I haven't put the FDisk output because it's long. It's two pages. It's interactive, unfortunately. So you cannot just plug in the data on the command line. So you run fdisk. Here it says you need to update the master boot record. It prompts us for input. Now, in this session, we tell it to change the partition 0. It has 0, 1, 2, and 3 partitions, 4 partitions in total. This is because this is the number of the partition MS-DOS used to support back in the years. We specified the file system type as MS-DOS. Now, one thing to watch is that it doesn't ask you for the word MS-DOS. It asks you for a number, and for MS-DOS, it's 11. And we have to set its boundaries. Now, imagine that you have any storage technology. Obviously, the fields, the records in it are indexed, numbered. So by specifying the boundaries, it means take that area from here to there and from there to the end and make, for example, 2 partitions. In our cases, we want to make just 1 partition, and we tell it to occupy the whole USB drive, and we make that active partition. The active partitions, again, are remnants of the DOS technology where you can boot only from an active partition. So finally, when we build that partition, we need to initialize the file system on it, and you run the command newfs msdos, and you finally build the file system. And then you have to mount the device. You mount the device, you create files in it, and then you unmount it, you take it to another laptop, you plug in there, and you copy your stuff. Now, one thing to note is that you have to use the sudo command to mount the stick. Now, back in the days, obviously, if you want to mount additional drives, that's actually highly dangerous and highly important stuff. So it was given in the hands of the root user. And this is why you need root in order to mount and unmount stuff. The thing is, nowadays, let's say if you share a laptop or a desktop or something with somebody else, like I did with my father 10 years ago, or 20 years ago, was my father okay if I just plug in random stuff on that desktop? He wasn't, but he didn't have much of a choice. Later in the university, I shared a desktop with my roommates. Was I okay if they plug in and plug random stuff? I wasn't okay, but I didn't have much choice. So for the other operating system, everything is open. You get hold of the computer if the person has not locked it in, or you find a logged in account, you put an USB, it mounts the USB, and they can do whatever they want. So one thing to note is that in the past, you can actually set up a sys control that's called VFS generic user mount to non-zero, and the non-root users will be allowed to mount anything. OpenBSD guys didn't like that approach. They disabled it altogether. For NetBSD, if your secure level is above 0, you cannot enable that CCTL. You can disable it if it is enabled, but you can enable it. You cannot enable it. Which means that imagine that you have some sort of a disaster. You boot into single user mode, or reduce the secure level, and then you mount your USB stuff so that you can restore whatever data you can restore. That's sort of a valid use case. CD and DVDs. I had no luck with plugging in CD and DVDs to the Pinebook. I have an Apple SuperDrive. I plugged it in. It refused to accept any CDs. I got another cheap thing from Amazon. I plugged it in. I was able to put a CD. It refused to spin it. So I don't know if the Pinebook doesn't support it, or if, which I doubt it, or if I simply bought crap.
I'm sorry, the Pinebook, I missed what you said it doesn't support.
External USB CD drives.
Oh.
So I tried with two and I failed. I always wanted to ask in their IRC.
If USB works, it should work too. I mean, the only difference is the file system.
I have two of them here. If you can make them work,
well,
I'll buy your beer.
Stuff only works with Apple.
Yes, this is why I bought the second thing. And well, we are, I mean, do they have external power switches? No, they're just like regular USB drives that get the that gets the voltage from the. Most probably, yes. Most probably, that's the most logical thing. In any case, so if you want to rip a music CD or if you want to mount any CD, Pinebook is not your thing. So most probably, unfortunately. Yes. So I guess that if you buy or if you get an old CD drive with external power supply, and you plug it into the Pinebook, and then you plug it into the electric outlet, you may get some results. That's actually a good idea. I will search for that thing. I'm going to quickly go through how you mount a data CD. So you plug in the CD, obviously, you run mount, and then you can copy something from the CD to your system, and then the only thing to be aware of is once you copy some files, they're usually owned by root, so most probably here you had to change on them so that they belong to your account. Ripping a music CD, we actually need two additional packages to extract music tracks from a CD. I was not able to test that thing on the Pinebook, but I was doing it on another NetBSD machine, so the information is correct. So you install CD Paranoia, you put the music CD in, you run sudo CD Paranoia minus B, which means batch of something like that, if I don't recall. So, and it rips all the music track from the CDs. You have certain choices. You can extract the third, the fifth, and the seventh. You can extract, you can specify what you want to extract, but if you want all of them, you just put minus B. You get the WAV files. Once you have the WAV files, you need to convert, if you want, you can convert them to MP3s, and then you install Blade Encoder, and then you run Blade Encoder star.wav. Now, one thing is that if you want the data about the CDs, which means the artwork, you can, back in the days, you were able to install it from the CD database. Unfortunately, the FreeDB is now extinct. They replaced it with gnudb.org, something like that, where you can download information about the CDs. There are actually two command line rippers in NetBSD collections that were able to fetch the CD data from the CD database. But they use the old FreeDB, which means they're at least 5 years they haven't been touched, maybe. And they simply crash because they cannot connect to the FreeDB. This is a good opportunity to send patches or to create a new package and rewrite them in shell script. Typesetting. Yes, actually, typesetting, it's a very interesting topic for me, mostly because I am a math graduate, and when I was studying math, I had to write quite a lot of stuff in Tech and LaTeX. So let's start. There are at least three text processing system on Unix. The original one, roff, groff, trough, and roff, we refer it here only as groff, tech, latex, and docbook. So the good thing about them is that they all separate the content from the presentation, and then the content can be transformed into several formats. Their input is usually some plain text interspersed with formatting comments, but the formatting comments are also like plain text, and they can be easily version controlled. Docbook defines its content in XML format. As far as I remember, I think, but I'm not quite sure, O'Reilly had a huge, I mean, they pretty much, they O'Reilly created it, the docbook thing. So if you write a book for O'Reilly, they may ask you to write it in docbook, which is good. So once you typeset your book or article, in XML format, you can use XCLT transformation to convert it to HTML, PDF, man pages, whatever you want, which is kind of cool because you have your source in one place, you run one or two comments, and you get multiple outputs. Tech and LaTeX, it's very popular for math typesetting. Tech defines low-level formatting, which means pretty much this is the pixel length, this is how you draw letters, this is how you leave vertical space, this is how you leave horizontal space. LaTeX defines more logical structures like books, articles, sections, subsections, table of contents, and so on. They produce output as DVI, PostScript, PDF. TechLife is a cross-platform distribution for tech typesetting. It's available as NetBSD package. Again, if you have interest in that type of stuff, if you have to write a lot of reports, technical documentation, I do recommend Tech. Now we are going to discuss in more details the NROF and GROF programs. They are part of the base system. Their input consists, as I said, plain text with formatting comments. Now the good thing, the thing about them is that they are programmable. You can have macros grouping several comments, and those macros, they can define the logical part of your document. So instead of explicitly centering a line and making it bold, and you say this is the title, you use a macro and you say this is my title. Now imagine that you have a document that uses those macros. You can redefine the macros in such a way that they actually change the appearance, which is the good thing. Now I don't have much experience with professional typesetting with GROF and TROF, but back in Sofia universities, I helped one of my professors type his textbook in celestial mechanics. So we were just sitting, typing, checking, double-checking, and so on and so on. And I asked him, listen, this is not how it looks in the books that are already published by the university publishing house. The guy said, don't worry, just type it. So on, we typed it, we proofread it, we submitted the tech document. And when we get back the final results, it looked like nothing we have typed in. So why? Because the guys from the publishing house, they had their own tech and LaTeX formats. They have redefined the classes, and it was simply amazing. So the other thing is, I remember some other guy was submitting an article. He wrote the article like in that format, just text. They printed the articles in two columns. Simply they changed the LaTeX class from article one comma to article with two commas. This was something very amazing. So I was quite surprised. And I have a story to tell about the publishing, but we need after we finish recording. So let's check the GROF with the MS package, which is one of the standard classes. I actually wrote the presentation in GROF. The structure of the of a Grove document looks like title, author, abstract, abstract begin, abstract end, numbered heading, paragraph, numbered subheading. That pretty means sections and subsections, sections or chapter and subchapters. If you want to put verbatim text, for example, a program listing, you use display start, display end, and you repeat those elements. So now the general form of the command that renders the document is Grove, you specify the package or the class, MS, you specify the output, you specify the input document, and you pipe it to the out document. So the command that renders the thing for the terminal, which is similar to man, this is you specify the output as ASCII, you put the input document, the output document, and then we open it with less, and you read it as if you're reading the man pages. Now, when I was writing that article, I had a couple of tmux windows, and the windows where I was developing that thing, I used just two panes. So in the right one, I had opened the raw Grove document in VI. In the left one, I was viewing the output with less. And I had a make file, which was running that command for me. So in VI, I was able to type column, exclamation mark, make, which runs a command inside VI. It ran Grove, and then in the pane with the less, I simply pressed capital R. It automatically refreshed my document, and yes, quite smooth. So in the final stages, which actually happened today, I generated the PostScript output, and the command to generate the PostScript is, again, Grove, you specified the output as PS, and there are many ways to convert the PS output to a PDF. One popular package is the Ghost script. Once you install it, you have the command ps to PDF. You convert it to PDF, and you send it to whoever you want to send it. And that's pretty much what I have written. There are a bunch of open problems, though. So not everything goes went that smooth. As I said, I had problems with the first boot up. The next thing is envstat. So in envstat, you can show the, you can view how much battery you have left. Theoretically, you can set up the critical values. So say that your battery drops to 50%, then obviously you want to get a message on the screen.
How does the battery life? I mean, I'm curious how the support is on NetBSD with hibernation.
No hibernation. There's so
no hibernation.
I leave the Pinebook open for all night. Of course, plugged into to the thing. When I wake up, it hasn't slept. It stays up. So the screen doesn't.
No dim.
No dim. No nothing.
Does anybody know?
The screen should turn off when you close the thing.
Well, yes. So there is. I don't know if the screen what happens when I close the lid, just because I cannot see. However, when I open it, there is a message. Lid has opened. So most probably, yes, NetBSD finds out if the lid has closed or. Lit has opened.
So what's the runtime on the battery with your configuration?
I would say if you actively use the Pinebook, about 3 hours. So
even without hibernation or
no,
frequency
I'm
control.
So just to test the battery monitoring. Below the warning or the critical values, you can have the PowerD daemon do something. So imagine that it falls, you set up the critical value to 5%. the battery goes to 5%, a power D kicks in, it runs some action, and let's say your action is to tell you you are out of juice, you risk data loss, I'm going to shut you down, and it gives you 2 minutes to save your work. No matter how what I did with mstat, no matter how I tried to set up the critical values, it simply didn't accept them. So I don't know if the mstat does not support Pinebook. I don't know if this is shortcoming, but this was my experience. And again, so nowadays people use laptops to do web browsing. I mean, you are not going to get first class experience with the text browsers. And that was from me. Any questions, remarks? Yes.
Did you try using links with trying to accept terms of service?
Yeah.
Oh. The question for the video audience.
Oh, yes. Okay. So the question was, when I was trying to connect to a public Wi-Fi where they need you to agree to terms and conditions, have I tried to use links? No, and I'll tell you why. Because I set up the WPI supplicant. I tried to connect to it. It gave me an error. I don't know the URL, I don't know what to open in links in order to accept the terms and conditions. So perhaps if I open links and type anything, it might have forwarded me to something. I didn't thought about it.
Yeah, I think it hijacks DNS for the time being, directs you to something local, and no matter what URL you ask for.
I forgot about that. I should have tried it, but I forgot.
Most of the captive
portals.
Captive portal, the second word. Most of the captive portals, not all, seem to require JavaScript. So I don't know how links would work.
Gotcha.
I mean, shouldn't, right? I mean,
yes. I mean, I tried it only with links. I could try it with e-links, W3MC, how it goes. But honestly speaking, this is sort of an exotic attempt. It was, you know, just to, how can I say, satisfy my own curiosity. What can I do and what can I?
The workaround historically with that and captive portals was to sniff for other MAC addresses of people who are connected and then change your MAC address to theirs.
Yes.
This is kind of a tangential question, but you mentioned the expect program. I think it was TCL expect that you were showing your
yes.
Strategy with it. Can you say more about it? It looked kind of cool. I don't really know what it
is. Yes. So imagine that you manage a server and your server all of a sudden starts throwing file system errors. So what do? You run FSCK. FSCK is an interactive program. So you have to sit down, read the thing, respond. Read the thing, respond. Read the thing, respond. Now, usually, once you, depending on the prompt, you usually put one and the same thing, but you have to be on the keyboard and you have to press it. So imagine that you want to automate all this. So expect it's a program that's written in TCL. So what you do with it is you write an expect script. Usually the expect script consists of you spawn a program and then you wait for something in its output. You provide some sort of regular expression matching, and you say if your output is this, you do this sort of action. So imagine that in the case of FSCK, if you see a bet I note or bet V note or whatever, you want to take a corrective action, which is, I don't know, I have forgotten it. So you say, if you see the prompt about vnode, send this string to fsck command, and it sends it. Now imagine that you bumped into an input, an output from fsck, where you can't decide what to do. So you say, in this case, you say interact, and it returns back the control to you. So it has now, over the last, 5 years, because of my work, my job is to automate stuff. I have all the programs that I built. I built them to be automatic. I don't want to be caught in the middle of the night. And I haven't used expect quite a lot. The last time I used it was when somebody handed me like 20 new brand new servers, brand new virtual machines, and I have to copy my SSH key to it, and I didn't want to type 20 times SSH copy ID. I didn't want to confirm the fingerprint of the server, so I wrote out an expect script, and it typed all the stuff that I was prompted.
Do you need a TCL environment set up in order to run it, or does it just like install a binary or something?
So you just need to install the TCL expect package on NetBSD. It automatically installs the TCL language for you. And yes, it installs the TCL interpreter, all the 9 yards. It's not like just a single binary statically linked. You're going to get all the stuff. Yes?
Question. Is there a PR for the MSTAT issue with critical levels?
Is there a what?
A problem report, a mass problem report.
I sent a message to NetBSD mailing list. Nobody replied it. NetBSD, the basic one. Yes, NetBSD users.
When was this?
2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago, February. Yeah.
Yes, somewhere around that. If you search for
NSTAT. Cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Client for server password policy is the same in the stock OS?
I'm sorry?
In the stock OS, is it the same? Like the 5%?
You mean if. No, I gave the 5% as an example. I was just saying that if you have the power daemon enabled, you can have it react on events like low battery, and you can run any pretty much arbitrary reactions when that event kicks in. If
it jumps to 5 or 3%, will it run on 0%?
No, it won't. I mean, if you go down to 0%, it simply shuts it off. I avoid that situation because in that case, next time you boot, it does the file system check, and you can ruin your file system if you don't shut it down properly. So all the unplugging I was doing was to test the battery monitoring and to test that I could not set the critical values. So if it goes to 0%, it doesn't hibernate. It simply dies. So also, I really hate running laptops on batteries. I always prefer them to plug them in, just because I had accidents on airports, internet cafes, and so on and so on. So if there is an outlet, an electric outlet, I plug them in.
Shut it down. Is this in the firmware or is it in the
suspend the machine or shut it down or whatever. And there's a bunch of scripts you can configure to when various things happen, like when the lid switch lid opens or closes, when the battery power goes down to warning or above warning or whatever.
But when it's suspended, it's not running, right? How does it know it's...
So in suspend, which is like ACPIS3, the machine is running in a very low power state. Mm-hmm. Memory is still powered, so RAM is still there. And there are certain actions that will wake the machine back up and return control to the operating system at full power. So when I take this laptop and I close the lid, this triggers a power D action that says, please suspend to the firmware. And then the firmware puts in a low power state indicated by the little blinking LED here, which probably nobody can see. And then when I open the lid again, it returns control of the full OS in full power. And the difference with suspend and hibernate is with hibernate, that writes content memory to non-volatile storage, to disk, and then shuts the machine down completely. And when you start it up again, it will notice that the state has written the disk, and then pick up where it left off, rather than doing a clean boot.
Yes?
Have you had any trouble with durability of the SD cards?
Nope. So...
Because you're booting and running off microSD.
Yes. Do you mean data loss?
Corrupted SD cards.
IO something.
So I use a lot of Raspberry Pis.
I do.
Discovered not use a very good power supply, if you do what they originally said was any phone charger, you will corrupt your SD cards regularly. But if you use a good power supply, you have no problems. Whereas I could see running out of power on the laptop could corrupt the SD card.
I think I had this laptop for 5 years, something like that. I don't recall. When I bought it, I do recall that I'm living in my current apartment for 4 years, and I have that Pinebook before that, so it makes it more than 4 years. Now, we had power problems in my previous apartment, so that was the only time when I was experiencing broken SD card. And by broken SD card, I meant that it was working. I shut it down. I shut down the laptop in the evening. The next evening, when I tried to boot, I couldn't boot. I was wondering what the hell is going on. I couldn't boot. Finally, I got pissed off, and I initialized another micro SD card. Actually, the same card, but I reinitialized it on another machine. I plugged it in, and it was able to boot up. So this was the only time when I had problems with corrupted micro SD card. So
your installation of NetBSD, do you swap?
Do I have swap?
Yeah.
Perhaps this is what the live image created. So I think yes, it has some swap partition. Do I know?
On top. Or swap info.
Would swap CPL work on the...
Swap info in FreeBSD, sorry.
Swap CPL and OpenBSD.
I don't know if it uses the swap.
Okay.
I guess that...
There's no swap.
There is no swap.
It's a good choice.
Over the years, I actually built quite a lot of desktops. And of course, when you build desktops and laptops and so on, when you install it from scratch, I remember I was doing quite a lot of arithmetics about the swap on the swap devices, how many swap should I allocate and so on and so on. Over the past years, especially with the BSD, especially actually with the OpenBSD, it has an option to pick up the default layout, and I always pick the default layout because I got lazy. So that's the same thing with the Pinebook. I downloaded the image, I installed it, and I never thought about the partitions. Which I have funny story to tell, but that's.
So you're just using microSD, you're not booting from eMMC, so you don't know anything about the support. Do you know what eMMC supports like in NetBSD?
Yeah, you can boot from eMMC on the Pinebook if you want. I think the Pinebook has a switch to toggle which one it boots from.
Yes, it has. So when you boot, it has a. Some message like interrupt to boot from the default, something like that. You can boot from Android if you.
Is it from the BIOS or is it using like grub or something?
Is it U-boot?
That's a U-boot.
I'm curious about eMMC just because the first time I was dealing with eMMC was with BeagleBones. And you could talk about problems with microSD cards and the corruption, which I dealt with, and I know the power supply issues. But it was all, I mean, the quality of the cards varied massively. I mean, I would go through, I had a few dozen of them. Because I was doing banging on them pretty hard with the BeagleBones, of building ports and whatever. But the EMMC used to at least have really crappy I/O. But that was, I mean, when all the support first came. I mean, that's a long. So I don't know what it's like now.
I read the same stuff as well. So EMMC, it's not very reliable. It's not very fast. I think that it was some sort of in between technology.
The BSD support was pretty recent, then. So it wasn't. There's some peculiarities. I don't do that stuff, so I don't know. Some peculiarities.
They both work. Same software stack talks to both of them.
Yeah.
There's a lot of variety in the quality of the hardware.
Any more questions?
I guess I just have one more thing.
Yes.
I've been tempted to buy one for a while.
Yes.
But I have so many damn laptops and throwaway ones.
The white ones are not available anymore.
Yeah,
you have
yeah.
to buy Pinebook Pro.
Yep. So I kind of envisioned them, number one, to hack on AR64.
Mm-hmm.
But also because I wanted the idea of having a laptop that when I travel and, you know, give me your money. Oh, hit my laptop. You know, like, I got $200 in my pocket and I got a laptop worth $100 off the parking lot, right? When I bought it. So I kind of looked at it that way. So I guess like the question of battery and hibernation, that's a bad one, right? I mean,
yes.
Not having hibernation S3, you know, is a bit of an issue. Obviously, being able to adjust, I mean, I guess M-limit, you could adjust the frequency, the CPU frequency, right?
Yes, the...
And also set, with PowerD, you can set, you know, at 5% shut down gracefully or whatever, right? That's...
PowerD, it's questionable. I was testing it, I couldn't get it working.
There's probably an issue with the driver for the particular I2C power battery monitor in the Pinebook.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I guess it's a problem of with the Pinebook.
It's possible, yeah. I should look into it further. I file a PR for this, but yeah.
And then the other thing is obviously with the travel laptop. I mean, Wi-Fi compatibility. I mean,
yes.
I don't know what the Wi-Fi is here. I think it's 5 gigahertz for the public. I'm not sure, but we're able to connect. I mean, I could ping.
Okay, so do you mean the 5G thing?
I'm not sure if the Wi-Fi. I don't use the Wi-Fi ever. I have my own internet out of my desk. But I think the Wi-Fi is some of the networks here at NYU are 5 gigahertz.
I use 5G at home.
With the Pinebook.
Yes, yes.
Okay, I didn't know that. Okay, that was a question I had earlier because I connected fine now, but it's using URTWN,
mm-hmm.
that driver. that's in.
Yes.
You're using a USB. You're using it.
No, I'm using the USB one.
And so what's the wireless chipset in the that's built in?
I think it's some other real tech thing that NetBSD doesn't have a driver for at the moment.
Okay.
I think it's one of the extremely badly documented ones that is a big
So speaking of wireless adapters, when I bought the Pinebook, I was pretty curious what wireless adapters it accepts. So I had money to waste, and I bought five or four. Most of them worked. This one worked the best. It means that yes. So the other ones, they were dropping, starting. This one works quite stable.
The other one I have success with. I haven't used them in a while, but it's run. There's some you could get in this like micro center run driver, which I think is the same in that business.
Mm-hmm. So. Yes.
I have a question. You're Bulgarian, right?
Yes.
So why are you using the Pinebook and not an Olimex Teres?
Which one?
The Olimex Teres. Bulgarian laptop with the same SoC.
Because I'm actually living in United States for quite a lot of time. And what's the name of the laptop?
The maker is Olimex. They're in Plovdiv.
Aha, yes.
And the laptop is called the Teres One.
I have to look it up. So, Back in the 80s, Bulgaria was producing some say 60, some say 80% of the electronics that was used in the Warsaw Pact. Of course, the Warsaw Pact doesn't exist anymore. So we had quite a lot of computer industry. So at the best days, the factories. It's quite a curious story, I guess. I mean, if you want, we can stop recording and I tell them.
Do you want me to stop streaming?
Yeah.